First of all, I have to thank Professor Ganguly and the Gut Microbiota and Probiotic Scientific Foundation and the organizers of the 9th Probiotic Society for giving me an opportunity to come here and listen to all the elegant speakers. I know Dr. Ganguly since my postgraduate days in PGI Chandigarh, and I have always envied his enthusiasm, his leadership qualities, and I don't know how he always so relaxed with his persistent smile. I'm really envious and want to know the secret behind that. One of my friend just said that, you know, you're a tough girl, and I said I have to be because I'm a female, and being at the end and when already the patience has given way, I have to do justice to my topic, and that's role of probiotics in infants. I'm talking mainly in context of developing countries. Well, India is a huge country, and 60% of the preterm births take place in India. Not because the rate of prematurity is higher in India, it's just because of the sheer number of births. We have 25 million births every year. We almost make one new Australia in India every year. The top causes of neonatal mortality are prematurity, complications during birth, and severe infections. And prematurity and severe infections, you would agree with me, probably could be prevented, or at least the mortality or morbidity could be reduced. So if you look at the neonatal and child mortality, 48% of under 5 child mortality is constituted by newborn mortality, and it is mainly due to preterms and low birth weights. And if you look at the causes of deaths, as I already said, that infections are a very important and a huge cause. So here we are, that can probiotics be that preventive strategy which can reduce the risk of infections and the morbidity associated with it, like necrotizing enterocolitis, which is related to the gut barrier, poor immune system, and bacteria translocation. Here I would like to just give the new definition of probiotics, which is in context with the pediatric population given by the European Society of Pediatric Gastrohepatology Association, that probiotics are not just the live cells, but they are also cells or components of the microbial cells which have a beneficial effect on the health and well-being of the host. What is behind this change in definition, I will talk about it very shortly. So probiotics are very extensively researched for various conditions in early childhood. I would be covering mainly neonates and preterm neonates, but since my topic is infants, I would be just covering a little bit of all infant mortality and infections, and especially infections like diarrhea, which are the major killers. The last 20 years have been called as a golden age of probiotics in neonatal medicine. That is because there have been so much of literature, there has been flooding of the literature on the use of probiotics in prevention of necrotizing enterocolitis, sepsis, and all-cause mortality related to that. And we'll quickly, in 15 minutes, see through this literature and tell you that there are gaps in the knowledge, and probably things are not so simple as, I think one of my pediatric colleagues said that, you know, use probiotics and every problem is solved. Let me first talk about probiotics in preterms. So there is a large meta-analysis which looked at 32 studies and a huge number of babies, probiotics versus no probiotics, and this is published in 2017, quite recent. And it did show that there is reduction in necrotizing enterocolitis. And this was minded in very small babies, less than 29 weeks, and also led to lowering of the mortality and the hospital stay, which, you know, we are usually bothered with. Let's look at if there's any evidence in the developing country. There are two studies. I'll just talk about one study, which is from Delhi only, and used in probiotic, which was a cocktail of probiotics. You've been hearing about the names of the probiotics since morning. The setting was a community setting in rural India, and the participants were low birth weight babies, that is babies less than 2.5 kilos. And the probiotics were administered in the early age, that is first 3 to 7 days. And the main outcome they were looking at was the possible bacterial infections. But mind it, this was not in the hospital setting. So the infection was ruled out on IMNCI algorithm, which is more clinical based. As I already said, that this was a mixture or a cocktail with eight probiotics and a large number, 668 infants randomized to probiotic and almost equal number to placebo. No statistically significant reduction in the serious possible bacterial infections was seen. There was some decreased days of hospital, but no reduction in the risk of rehospitalization. You know, whenever you don't get anything in a large study, what you do a subgroup analysis. So a subgroup analysis was done in smaller babies, babies less than 2 kilos, and could find that there was reduction in the possible serious infections. But here I would like to mention that there were a lot of limitations about this study, the definitions of the sepsis, the diagnosis, post-hoc analysis. And the colonization of the stools did not take place. That means the cold chain was not maintained. That is one of the problems in developing country and many other factors. And this was a field trial. Well, if we look at high quality evidence, then there is a very good meta-analysis which was done by the Enabris group in 2014, which did show that there was this forest plot showing that if we look at the probiotic versus the control group, the probiotic group did favor neck. But then, you know, the protocols used were very different. Different probiotics were used. The duration was different. So ultimately, you know, if you have that kind of heterogeneity, you know that even in a meta-analysis or systemic review, you are comparing oranges with apples. Well, there is a large meta-analysis which is done by Dr. Deshpande's group. He's from Australia, and they are very much pro-probiotics. And they looked at large number of studies, and after sieving, they could collect 23 studies from 10 low and middle income countries like India in 4 continents. And they could find that there was a reduction in the NEC rate. The number needed to treat were 25. That means if you treat 25, you could prevent neck in one patient. Late onset sepsis was also lower, and NNT were 25, and all-cause mortality also could be reduced. So far it looks very good. But if you look at the limitation and strengths of the studies used in this meta-analysis, there were variations in the probiotic protocols, like different set of probiotics were used, the duration was different, and nearly 40% trials carried higher risk of bias. And even the authors very well said in the conclusion that there is a need to develop or improve access to high quality, safe and effective probiotics, and use of probiotics for research or for routine use in preterm neonates is an open-ended question. Well, there is a very beautiful study which is from UK, and I'm a great admirer of UK studies because, I mean, it's a soft corner. And this was a large study which was done with the probiotic, which is like one of the friendly probiotic in the breastfed newborn gut, that is Bifidobacterium breve. And they use it to prevent NEC, necrotizing enterocolitis, late onset sepsis, and death in preterm babies, while also monitoring the colonization of the gut, which is a sure shot method of knowing that the probiotic which you use was effective. The participants were again very tiny, small babies, 23 to 30 weeks, and they were enrolled within 48 hours. So the probiotic was used against the placebo. Large number of babies in a single multicentric trial. And unfortunately, the primary outcomes did not show any benefit, whether in sepsis, necrotizing enterocolitis, or in death. But the colonization status was available in almost 94% of the surviving babies at 2 weeks. 61% were positive. 85% of the probiotic group and 37% of the placebo. That means in NICU, which are like small, and the caretakers take care of large number of babies, there could be cross-colonization. That means those babies who are not even getting probiotics may get colonized. So that's why 37% of colonization was seen in the control group also. Though no harm associated with the intervention was reported, but one of the biggest limitations of the study was cross-colonization of the placebo arm, which could not be reduced, which could have reduced the statistical power and confounding the results. There are small studies which looked at the effect of probiotics on the growth, and this is one study from the German neonatal network, and they found a positive result. But the question is that, you know, in the end, we are going to look at what have been the gaps in the knowledge, and are we at a platform where we can say that, okay, we make these guidelines, these are WHO guidelines or they are Indian guidelines and they should be followed up, or they are IAP guidelines and they should be followed up. Well, let's look at diarrhea in infancy. We know that diarrhea is one of the major killer and a cause of under 5 child mortality in developing world. We know that the affected nutritional status leads to impairment of cell-mediated immunity, IgA concentration, and cytokine production, which leads to increased risk of infection and episodes of acute and recurrent diarrhea. 30% of the world's infant population suffers from malnutrition, belong to developing countries. And if we look at the mortality, the burden of mortality is pretty huge in South Asia and Africa. Should we give probiotics for treating persistent diarrhea in children? Well, there is a systematic review which shows that there is effect in reduction of the duration of the persistent diarrhea and decreased stool frequency and shorter hospital stay. I'll forget about short bowel and I'll leave that for the gastroenterologist. So there's a very good and a beautiful guideline which is given by the world, given in one of the World Journal Gastroenterology way back in 2017 December, which very categorically shows that where you can use probiotic, which is the best combination, and what is the quality of the grade. And you can see that in acute gastroenteritis, you can use it for treatment. It should be considered, and what are the strains to be used. Similarly, in antibiotic associated diarrhea, it could be preventive. In traveler diarrheas, there is no need. So similarly, you know, they have given pretty good guidelines, but in necrotizing enterocolitis, somehow they have left it as a decision to be discussed with the parents. Why they have done so, I will discuss with you very shortly. So in last 10-15 years, everybody has started talking about the benefit of probiotics in developing world, in eradicating poverty, in eradicating diseases related to poverty like HIV, diarrhea, and problems related to prematurity. The thing is that most of the trials come from the West. Most of the products which are available in developing countries, especially where it is like a food, the quality maintained by the pharmacological companies cannot be assured. So, somebody I think mentioned that we've been eating fermented foods for ages. I remember my grandmother saying that, you know, if I eat a roti or fermented dough, it's digested better. So, should we look at our locally prepared fermented foods? I'm talking, of course, not in newborns, I'm talking about in adults. So there is a lot of debate and there are people who are talking about it. But I think most of the people are saying that we need more research from the developing countries. And the reason behind that is that there are still gaps in research. And next two slides or in next 5 minutes, I'll try to argue what are the gaps in research. We don't know what is the target. We don't know what kind of gut microbiota we are trying to target. You're saying that the newborns in South Africa has different microbiota and in India have different microbiota. So if we don't know what we are targeting, then what are we doing? Second is, what is the clinical outcome which we are looking at when we are targeting something? Is it diarrhea? Is it prevention of infection? Or is it prevention of allergies? So, and many a times, you know, we calculate our sample on basis of one clinical outcome. And then, you know, we suddenly find that, you know, a second, third outcome has also come down, and we say that, you know, it also reduces this, it also reduces this. So probably we have to plan the study in a manner that we know what we are targeting and we know what are the clinical outcomes we are looking at. Also exploring the feeding contribution. The previous speaker talked about human milk. It's rich in microbiota. It's rich in prebiotic, like human oligosaccharides, which provide food to the microbiota, and then has other defense materials like lactoferrins and other immunoglobulins. So nobody has studied that. What is the confounding effect of the breastfeeding? Breastfeeding versus formula feeding. Their gut microbiota is very different. So we have to look at that. We have to devise the studies where we look at the effect of human milk, mother's own milk and donor milk. Breast milk banks are coming up, and a lot of people are using donor milk also. The donor milk are also rich in microbiota or not. Also choosing the microbiota. You know, like, it's not that you'll use any strain or any numbers, maybe multiple, I don't know, but probably that has to be seen. And another very important safety concern which we are not addressing is that, you know, on the probiotics, there is also fear of probiotic related sepsis, especially in immune compromised hosts. When you're talking about extremely preterm babies, we are talking about malnourished children, and transmission of antibiotic resistance. And the antibiotic resistance may not be primarily because of gene related to the probiota, but what they will transfer to the other opportunistic bacteria, which may become pathogenic. And the non-availability of high quality products. Also choosing the study design, the challenge of cross-colonization, especially in our NICU, where there is so much of cross-colonization, and maintaining the cold chain. So if I look at the same gaps and translate them to the developing countries, there's lack of definitive guidelines or recommendation for use of probiotic in developing countries. My friend said that we use in PGI, but then PGI is not the standard for the whole country or for the whole developing world. A body like WHO, a body like IAP has to stand up and say that, okay, these are the guidelines. Is the guidelines for the developing world or for the India? And manufacturing lacks a strict quality regulation. Choosing the probiotic, is there strength in strains or numbers? The extreme variety of probiotic use might lead to conflicting conclusion, and then people will just stand up and say that, oh, there is no need of further research. Use probiotic left, right, or center. I'm not against. I'm for it, but I'm saying that, you know, we have to address the gaps in the knowledge, especially in developing countries. And further structured research is needed to address the benefit of a single strain versus the multiple strain. I would like to finish here with just a few takeaway messages that there is still lack of awareness in developing countries, you know, like, okay, consume Yakult as much as you can, but the whole knowledge and translation probably has not come. Lack of regulations which can ensure the quality and standards of probiotics. High risk of production of unreliable products. Cooperation between various stakeholders to improve access to high quality, safe and effective probiotics in developing countries where the risk is more. Probiotics for research or routine use depend on the national or health priorities or the ethics. We have to choose. And I'm saying so because there are biggies over here. And probably there's need for more research in this field, especially in the developing world. Thank you very much for listening to me. I agree this is the golden age of probiotics, but we have to create a balance between use and abuse of probiotics. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr.